John chapter 16, verse 26. At that day ye shall ask in my name, and I say not unto you, Jesus said, that I will pray the Father for you. For the Father himself loveth you, because ye have loved me, and have believed that I came out from God. Holy Father God, we humbly but sincerely thank you for your holy word. Thank you for your love and your mercy and grace. For it has been said that your holy word is not given to us to just gain knowledge, but to gain a better relationship with you, to get to know you better, and for you to impart unto us what we need to fellowship with you. We praise you and we thank you for your holy Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, we pray as your gospel is preached from the gospels, we pray that your Holy Spirit will move mightily on the hearts and minds of those who don't know Jesus Christ as Savior. Bless your people as well. In Jesus Christ's name we pray and for Savior. Amen. You may be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, Clovis G. Chapel said, as the saints of God meet together, Jesus still manifests himself. And seeing him, there comes to us a new joy and peace, a new sense of the purpose and worthfulness of life. Seeing him, there comes to us a new power for battle and for conquest. Notice he said, a new power for battle and for conquest. Too many of us love the victory. We love the celebration. And by the way, I'm big on celebration. I believe Jesus is big on celebration. I believe God is big on celebration. As I told you in one of the first sermons I preached in this series, there is a professor, I think a preacher, both have said recently that if you don't have a point of celebration in your life, then life is not worth living. You ought to get some victories by the grace of God and celebrate every victory. That's what one guy said, celebrate everything. One guy said, celebrate everything. Another guy said, celebrate every victory. Even if it comes every day of the week, celebrate. And that's what makes life wonderful. So I'm big on celebration. But too many of us like the celebration, but we don't like the battle. You see, the celebration is sweeter when the battle is tough and difficult. So learn how to, as I've shared with you in the past, learn how to love the fight. Learn how to love the battle. Amen, somebody. Learn how to love the battle. Learn how to love the tough times. And then you will really enjoy it. Celebration times. Be that as it may, beloved, in these two verses, Jesus extends his revelation of how his disciples and all believers will be able to communicate with the Father after his ascension. When we think of Jesus' activity in heaven, we normally recall those passages in Romans chapter 8 and Hebrews 7, which speak of Jesus interceding for us. And by the way, Jesus is still interceding for us right now. Thanks be to God. Because the truth of the matter is, you probably have nobody praying for you. those who are you are truly blessed when you've got somebody praying for you by name. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
And you ought to be praying for somebody by name. But as we look at Jesus' words in this text, we find that we ourselves are given direct access to the Heavenly Father in the holy name of Jesus Christ in the new day of grace, following Jesus' death, burial, resurrection, and ascension, as we are now able to pray in His holy name. Jesus' name is sweet to God's ears. You can't get your prayers answered in your name because you're with Him. Jesus, however, died for your sins and for mine. And so His name is sweet. God said, this is my Son in whom I am well pleased. He sent Him to die on the cross for us and to shed His blood for us as the Lamb of God, who took away the sins of the world, was buried and rose again because He's not pleased with us. In fact, in the Old Testament, the Bible says that God is angry with the wicked every day. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Bible Knowledge Commentary states the coming new day would give the disciples intimacy with the Father and clarity of understanding. The disciples would have direct personal access to the Father by the name of, that is, through Jesus. Jesus would no longer need to pray on their behalf since they could ask for themselves. This does not negate the fact that Jesus is still praying for us at the right hand of God. But you have access now to pray to God for yourself. You think that you're being oppressed. You think that you're being mistreated. You're going through some kind of persecution. Pray to God the Father in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's power right there. Amen, somebody. I assure you of that. Stop worrying and fretting. Stop choosing to be evil and disobedient and rebellious and then thinking that God and people are going to put up with it. Pray to God and ask God to change you. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Pray to God that God will change you and help you to be what He wants you to be so that you can live the blessed life. Thank God for those Christians who are living the blessed life because they're obedient to God. Those so-called Christians who are not obedient to God, we need to pray for them. Because you are going against God's will, and that is not a good thing. It's not going to work for you. That's not going to end pretty. So pray to God and ask God, in the name of Jesus, to change you from the inside out, to help you to stop being bitter, resentful, and hateful, a liar, a thief, a cheat. And ask God to help you to do it His way, by the power of the Holy Spirit, to have a great attitude, to be cheerful no matter what you go through, to live by the holy word of God no matter what is going on. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, importantly, we should remember that this truth does not negate the promise of Christ's intercessory work in overcoming a believer's sin. However, the disciples were now in a personal love and faith relationship with the Heavenly Father because of what Jesus Christ about to do for us. Only children have this privilege of access to their Father. Jesus says, for the Father Himself loveth you. God loves you. If you don't feel like your Father loves you, God loves you. If you do not feel like your mother loves you, God loves you. You better anchor your love in God. You better be about pleasing Him and not trying to please a mean and cantankerous and hateful mother or father or sibling or boss. If they don't love you, if your co-workers don't love you, God loves you. Appeal to Him. Pray to Him in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and do what He tells you to do. And you'll be amazed at how that once you're right with God, how that even your enemies will be at peace with you according to the Bible. Amen, somebody. God loveth you. He utters these words before He goes to the cross. He is telling His disciples that they can go to the Father because the Father loves them of His own will. Someone once said, Jesus did not go to the cross to make God loving. He went to the cross to show us that God is loving. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
You serve a loving God. Don't you worry about a thing when you understand that you serve a loving God. God the Father did not make Himself the enemy of man. It was man who made himself the enemy of God, building up the wall of sin between himself and God, who is holy. Our sinfulness necessitated the coming of a mediator who could stand between us and God. His name is Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus says the disciples could approach God, because ye have loved me and have believed that I came out from God. My God, my God, what kind of thing is going on here? Jesus came out from God. You disciples, you believe that. You were the first to believe. While it is good to know that the Father loves us even in our sinful state, it is futile to approach God in prayer or otherwise without being in love with Jesus or loving Jesus and believing that He is in fact God and that He came from God. You've got to believe that. And that He is God, Emmanuel, God with us. He came from God. He is God, therefore. We do not have to convince God to listen to or answer our prayers. He wants to hear from us and answer our prayers. We are His children, and He is more eager to answer our prayers than we are to pray. Ladies and gentlemen, it was the great man of prayer, George Mueller, who said that true prayer was not overcoming God's reluctance, but overcoming God's willingness. My, my, my. How about that, dear saints? Well, then why are you not getting your prayers answered, dear Christian friend? Is it because you're mean as the devil? Is it because, husband, you don't love your wife? Your wife? You hate your wife? You don't talk to your wife, and God says, don't talk to me unless you talk to your wife. How about it, dear prayer warrior wife? You cut your husband off from sex and from a good meal, talking about you want to close yourself off in spirituality and prayer and fasting. Well, he does not agree to that. Well, he wants romance and he wants love. I'm reminded of a preacher who was in jail overseas, being persecuted and tortured for years, and came back to a cantankerous wife who had lied on him and everything else. And whereas this man wanted some love, he caught hell. What a great wife she was. Not. Yet you want to be this prayer warrior. Reminded of the wife who says she wanted to fast it for fasting 40 days and 40 nights. Left the husband hanging. He was trying to hang in there and kept knocking on the door one day, and she wouldn't answer at all. Found out she died. Don't be so heavenly minded, you're no earthly good. You still got obligations and business to take care of with your husband and with your wife. You're super spiritual people. Why are your prayers not answered? Do you still have a girlfriend on the side? Or you still lusting after another woman? You still on Ashley and Madison, even though the preachers have died because of that? You still won't pay your taxes? Jesus paid his. Are you a liar? Are you a thief? Are you a Simon? Ananias and Sapphira? Are you a Sanballat or a Tobias or a Judas? That's why God is not hearing your prayers, because you're full of hell and the devil and sin. And you refuse to confess it. You refuse to repent of it. Are you perpetuating a lie that you told 20 years ago with the same face you're trying to still keep that lie up? Even when somebody brings it up and gives you the proof, you lie about it. There's some folks in the church who lie worse than Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump combined. And if you're not getting your prayers answered, you're living a miserable, pitiful life with your sin. God will never hear your prayers or answer your prayers until you confess your sins and repent and get your heart right with God. Don't bow your head yet. It's not time to pray. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Confess your sins and repent. Stop being stubborn. Stop being rebellious. Stop being more concerned about money than you are about God. Stop being cantankerous. Stop being mean and hateful. And then expect God to bless you. And the only time you can smile and be happy is when things are going the way you want them to go. Ladies and gentlemen, just the knowledge of how God sees us is enough to bring joy to our hearts in any situation. In closing, John Newton said, my baby son found this over the day, and not the other one. John Newton said, I asked the Lord that I might grow in faith and love and every grace, and might more of his salvation know and seek more earnestly his face. 'Twas he who taught me thus to pray, and he, I trust, has answered prayer. But it has been in such a way it almost drove me to despair. I hoped that in some favored hour and once he'd answer my request, and by his love's constraining power, subdue my sins and give me rest. Ladies and gentlemen, you can take part in the joy that Jesus fulfilled in his disciples by trusting Jesus Christ as your Savior, believing on him. And he died for your sins, was buried, and rose again. Just acknowledge that you are a sinner and that you have broken God's laws. You've broken God's Ten Commandments. For we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And we all deserve hell, and we're on our way to hell if we don't trust Jesus Christ as Savior. If we don't believe in him as our Savior, for the Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Just believe in your heart in the Lord Jesus Christ. Believe that he died for your sin, was buried, and rose again. And pray and ask him to come into your heart to save your soul. For the Bible says in Romans 10:9, that if thou shall confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shall believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou you shalt be saved. Saved from what? Saved from sin and hell. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Saved from sin and hell, and saved to heaven by the grace of God. Just believe. We're already ruined. We're already messed up. You've already sinned. You can't go back and change it. can't go back and undo it. There's a little saying going among the millennials now. Once you see it, you can't unsee it. Once you do it, you can't undo it. Can somebody say amen? Might as well just confess your sins and admit it. And then believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says, and thou you shall be saved. I'm willing to lead you in prayer. If you're willing to follow me in prayer, to get saved tonight. Follow me phrase by phrase and mean it from your heart, believing in your heart in the Lord Jesus Christ. Holy Father God, I acknowledge my sins. I admit that I have sinned against you, that I have done some evil things in my life. I have broken your Ten Commandments. I'm sorry for my sins. Help me to repent of my sins. As I now believe with all of my heart that Jesus Christ died on the cross for my sins, was buried and rose again. Lord Jesus, please come into my heart and save my soul. Change my life. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Help me to repent of my sins and to follow you in new life. In Jesus Christ's name I pray for his sake. Amen. He will save you. Yes, now. Yes, now. Jesus will save you. Jesus will save you. Yes, now. Dear friend of mine, if you believe in your heart in the Lord Jesus Christ for your salvation tonight, that he died for your sins, was buried and rose again, allow me to say congratulations on trusting the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, for indeed you have done the most important thing in life, and I guarantee you that you will never regret it. For more information to help you grow in your newfound faith in Christ, go to GospelLightSociety.com and read by pamphlet what to do after you enter through the door. Jesus Christ said in John 10:9, I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture.